What we're going to do right here is go back, way back into time.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our session this evening. I'm Brina Montoya from North Carolina State University and one of the proceedings co-editors for this conference. It's been wonderful working on this conference for a couple years now, and so excited that you all are here in LA to enjoy it. We're excited today for our first ever Prakash lecture given by Dr. Jason DeJong. And before that, we have a couple exciting geopits to kick us off.
Okay, good afternoon, and welcome to part two of the sixth annual, or whatever it is, GeoPit. So we're going to hear some more powerful, informative talks here now from the Greek Mafia, actually. And they named themselves that. So I want to welcome Nick McCarris. He's the Chief Data Officer for Hayling Aldrich, and Taki Chrysovergis, who's a principal with... SPC Engineering. So we're going to hear a little bit about the future and then the past with AI and then forensics. So welcome, Nick, and let's get this ball rolling.
All right. Hello, everybody. I'm really happy to be here, and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Anand. Thank you, Sissy. So originally, I called this the risks and opportunities of artificial intelligence, but I realized that in 12 minutes, I cannot do all of them. So it's some of them. A little bit of a disclaimer. This presentation contains no AI-generated content unless otherwise noted. So this is because ChatGPT now is everywhere. So you have news anchors saying, hey, you know, this and this happened. Oh, by the way, ChatGPT said that. And the other one is, why should you care about this? So I'll start with this. Fundamentally, I believe that geoprofessionals manage risk, and AI can help. Now, very brief definitions so that we all are on the same page. Sometimes machine learning is considered to be a subset of AI. I prefer this definition from Professor Rashka, where AI is actually not a, machine learning, sorry, is not a subset of AI, but they actually overlap. So when we think of AI, usually it's robotic vehicles, autonomous vehicles. These are systems that take inputs from the environment and they try to maximize their chances of success. Machine learning, this is mostly where we are at as a geoprofession and the way we experiment with machine learning. This is regression classification problems, and we do a lot of work there because it fits our workflows. And of course, in the middle, deep learning, and now we have generative AI, and ChatGPT, of course, popularized this field. There's obviously a lot of interest in artificial intelligence and machine learning. This is a very quick count of articles in the earth sciences, so this doesn't only include the geoprofession, but it's here just to show you this rapid interest that it's growing so rapidly, and there's really a lot of interest in AI and machine learning in our field. And there were some great presentations today. There's a lot of interest in that within this conference as well, and I only see it growing, actually. So let me talk to you about some of my observations so far. So what I've seen is there's mostly regression and classification studies in the form of proofs of concept. So we do a lot of those, and that's good. It's very good that we do that. There are so many neural networks. So usually when someone gets started with AI, the first thing they do is experiment with neural networks. I don't know why that is, maybe because it has a fancy name. And I'm noticing that we don't really have any significant or production-ready AI and machine learning applications, at least not yet. So this is an area where I'm really interested. This is where I'm focusing now. some things that may be obvious. I see that many academics know how to build good models, but they don't have access to good and a lot of data, and that's a problem. And then many public agencies or private companies, they have data, but they may not know how to build the models. So we need to do something to pair these organizations together. Data management is a whole different topic. I'm not going to talk about this here, but it's something that we should seriously consider improving. So how are we doing? Based on the articles that I have read and articles that I have reviewed, again, mostly these are regression and classification problems, or studies, I should say, and they are suspiciously perfect, many of them. So with regression, what we see is perfect accuracies above 90%, classification, same thing. And the first thing I do is I say, show me the data, because once we look at the data and we try to go beyond the data set that the researchers used, then we see something like this. We put things into perspective. So there's a whole universe of possibilities, and what we have is we have pockets of brilliant researchers, nonetheless, who are just focusing on their small data sets, and they're building models around those data sets. The problem is then that these data sets, we cannot generalize, we cannot build models that allow us to use, let's say, AI to design deep foundations or other elements in different and varying conditions. ChatGPT, again, I'm going to mention that a few times. One of the reasons why it's so significant nowadays is because they push the boundaries. They train and they build a massive model, the newest one, over a trillion parameters, many, many terabytes of data. So we can do that, or can we do that? That's actually a question. So let's see. As far as the geo profession is concerned, oftentimes we wonder, is this a gimmick or is there real value? And what I see is our design methods are primarily empirical or semi-empirical, which means that they're actually primed for to be restudied or revamped with artificial intelligence. And the case in point here, this is a figure from Norlum 1963, bedding capacity of piles in cohesion-less soils. This is a method that we use a lot, and it was built on 42 pile load tests, or it was derived from 42 pile load tests, I should say. So here's something to think about. Imagine what we would do if we were able to train models on 50, 100, 200,000 pile load tests. This is something that I'm absolutely convinced about, that if we were able to use the data we would of all of these load tests, we would absolutely be able to build a model that generalizes and dramatically improves the design of deep foundations in this case. So if you know me, you know that something that's really important to me is situational awareness. So in this presentation, I'm not going to go any deeper into the specifics of AI, or this talk, I should say. I want to just pause and think with you here, where are we? So this is a figure from Gartner. It's called the Gartner Hype Cycle. And what it does is it shows the different stages that maybe a technology breakthrough goes through in its journey of maturity, let's say. So first it starts, innovation trigger, something new, a lot of interest. A lot of people get into that. They learn more about it, they experiment, proof of concept and whatnot. And there's a point where they reach the peak of inflated expectations when they realize that, well, maybe things are not what we think they are. And then we go through the other steps, eventually leading to, and hopefully, the plateau of productivity eventually. I like to think of this also with respect to the levels of competence. I think they match really well. So at the bottom, you have unconscious incompetence, something very new. We don't know what we don't know. And then as we gain more experience, we go through these levels to eventually be unconscious, to essentially gain unconscious competence. This is where we stand with regards to the entire tech world. You can find this figure, it's available online if you want to. A few things that you notice here, generative AI is near the peak, and deep learning is at the trough of this right now, where things are being rethought and revisioned with regards to what it can do. This is as of July 2022. ChatGPT was not out. I'm actually looking forward to see what's going to happen with it being out. So I'd like to ask you, where do you think we are on our journey, meaning AI, machine learning in the geoprofession? Are we just experimenting still? Have we reached the peak of inflated expectations? Are we going through the trap of disillusionment, slope of enlightenment, plateau productivity? I have my own opinion. I think we're near the peak, but I'd like you to think about that as well. So, obviously, I couldn't go through this talk without bringing up ChatGPT. And you have your fair warning here. What follows is AI-generated content. I would like, again, to pause for a second. Even the fact that, at this moment, we're about together here to see how well an AI model did answering this question is fascinating. Regardless of how well it does, it's still fascinating. So here's a prompt. I need to design the foundation system for a 12-story residential building in downtown Boston. What do you propose? So it starts with this. Designing a foundation system for this building requires considering the soil conditions, building loads, local building codes. Here are some proposed steps for designing a suitable foundation system. So here's our intro. And we go through the steps. One, conduct a site investigation. Okay, so far so good. Determine the loads on the foundation. All right, I don't think I'm gonna, as a geotech, I don't think I'm the one calculating the dead and live load, but fair enough, I'll take that. Number three, select the foundation type. Based on soil conditions, choose a suitable foundation type. All right. Size of the foundation, again, so far so good. And now here, consider the seismic hazard. Boston is located in the moderate to high seismic hazard area. I said, hold on a minute. I'm not an expert in Boston, but I can look up a map. That's not what we have. So it went on to come up with some other recommendations. So I said, okay, let me make it more specific. What, not just what you proposed, what foundation system do you propose? So based on the information you provided, it says I propose a combination of drill piles and a mat foundation. And it goes through the steps of defining what drill piles are, what mat foundations are. And the good point here is it tells us that we should consult a geotechnical engineer. Thank God. Now, the recommendation is not optimal. I talked to my colleague, Damien Siebert, who's an expert in this field, and he knows that that's not optimal, but we can optimize this model, and this is amazing. So there are ways that we can make this better with information from geotech tools, you name it. This is something we're working on. So I'm gonna leave you with this. I get this question a lot. Will AI replace me? And my answer is no, but a geoprofessional who knows how to use AI likely will replace you. So, thank you.
Okay. So, for those of you who are here this morning for the GeoPit talks, just to let you know, I don't have the voice that Jay McKelvey has, and I certainly don't have the guitar skills that Jay McKelvey has. but I will be speaking on something I am passionate about. And that is geotechnical forensics, building your toolbox. So, what do I mean by toolbox? Well, if we think about it, in a toolbox in a garage, we may have a wrench, we may have a screwdriver, we may have a hammer, all these different tools that we need to do whatever we need to do. How about a geotechnical toolbox? Okay, we may have using boring CPTs, geophysical surveys, be able to do foundation design, slope stability analysis as an example, finite element analysis. These are all tools that we use as geotechnical engineers. And for the most part, we're pretty comfortable with using those tools. We're pretty proficient at that. But oftentimes, a forensic analysis and investigation requires tools outside of our conventional toolbox and what we're comfortable with. So let's go over just some broad categories of what, at least in my opinion, a forensic toolbox includes for geotechnical engineering. One would be collection of historical data. That could be finding old geotechnical reports. It could be collecting historical era photographs, topographic data, whatever you name it. Field investigations. Right, so it could be borings, could be geophysical surveys, could be field monitoring. Our geotechnical analysis and presentation of the results. And this one seems like such a simple item, but we're doing all this work, all this analysis, and if we're not distilling it in a way where the audience can understand these complex ideas, then we're not doing our job the right way. And the audience could be a jury or a judge or it could be a city official. Now, if we just say for a moment that we take our forensic tools and we make them into 10, say our toolbox has 10 tools available to us, I'm gonna go through a few examples and scenarios that we can use as part of a forensic investigation. So let's say an emergency landslide repair. Okay, if we have 10 tools available, we're not going to be using all 10 for this type of investigation. So here, say we use 7 of the 10, and that could include topographic surveying, could include inclinometers for instrumentation and monitoring, could include collecting topographic data from before the landslide, right? Here's another example. Say that there's potential building damage due to a deep excavation adjacent to it. Again, we're not going to be using all 10, but we're going to be using different types of tools than we would use for the landslide repair. So that may involve different types of instrumentation and monitoring. So for a deep excavation, the types of ground movements are in the order of inches or millimeters. Whereas if we look at the landslide, those ground movements are on the order of feet or meters. So we're obviously using different types of tools. We're using different methodologies to approach the ground movements and resulting damage. Let's look at another example. Let's say there's a tunneling project and there's resulting sinkholes from that tunneling work. As Nick pointed out in terms of large data AI, there's oftentimes TBMs can produce millions or tens of millions of data points. It's a tool and a skill to actually be able to process through that data and understand it for our investigation, right? So these are different types of tools that are being used for each of these projects. And say that there's a residential tract development and there's expansive soil damage. Okay, there's different types of tools as well. We're dealing with large areas. We're dealing with potentially surveying the floor slabs and seeing the deformation as a result of the expansive soil movement. So each of these, let's look at this. Each of these different scenarios requires a different set of skills. And all of them have skills that are outside of our normal toolbox. So let's look at historical data, because a lot of these things are underutilized, and I want to bring those to the forefront. So for example, aerial photographs. Okay, why am I bringing up aerial photographs? It's such a simple idea, but we see so often that that information is not collected and is being left and underutilized. So there's aerial photographs from all over the country from the early 1900s through here, and we may be looking at those aerial photographs over the course of decades, or even over the course of months, and seeing the changes between those photographs and collecting that information and using that as one of the tools as part of our investigation. Okay, topographic geologic maps, past geotechnical reports, public building records, how the infrastructure was constructed. These are all important things. I want to highlight digital elevation data just as an example. I think we're, if we think about that first scenario, which was the landslide, okay, we can collect the topographic data after the landslide occurred, but what about before the landslide occurred? That information is very important for us to perform our slope stability back analysis, et cetera, and USGS has great LIDAR data publicly available that we can use to recreate the topography before the landslide. But if we think about that second scenario, say a deep excavation resulting in building movement, that LIDAR data doesn't have enough precision for us to do our analysis, and we may need to move to something more robust, like say INSAR data and other types of more precise data. So field investigation, okay, field mapping, surveying, remote sensing. I think we're all familiar with drone surveys and all that, but having that in-house as a tool instead of having to subcontract it out. Let me give you an example. In Southern California, I'm dealing with a landslide that crossed three properties, and that landslide occurred a year ago, okay? So we performed a drone survey, we collected our information, we got high quality images that saw the ground cracks and all that. Now, as you may know, Southern California and all of California had an extremely heavy rainy winter. So January of this year, there was another generation of movement, both in the previous slide area and additional slide area. We dispatched out right away, performed another survey, and found that snapshot in time. February, there was another generation of movement. So we were able to survey that again. And the value of having that in your own toolbox is that we have control of the data. We have the same staff collecting data every single time. We're not relying on different subcontractors and their availability and all that. We're able to do it in-house and at a moment's notice. Subsurface exploration, we all know about that. So forensic analysis, okay, we have our conventional geotechnical tools that we know and love, our foundation analysis, our settlement calculations, our finite element, we have all that. But there's a couple other things that I just want to highlight that are beyond that, that are oftentimes underutilized. One is utilizing geospatial data. So that's taking historical data and compiling it with data that we collect from the field. So this is an example. It's a warehouse in Southern California. We were called out because there's a lot of distress to the building. There was differential foundation settlement. And as you can see here, the slab was poured to slope, right? But you can see that on the upper part of the image, the contour lines are relatively consistent, right? But on the bottom, there's basically a trough, and there's we found a 7 to 8 inch differential foundation settlement across that area. And okay, so what we did is we looked at, before we did any subsurface exploration, we looked at historical topographic maps, geologic maps, and they did not indicate any features in that area. But what we did is we overlaid an aerial photograph from the early 1900s, and there's a stream running right through that trough, okay? So that helped in our selection of subsurface exploration methods and helped our investigation. Now here's another example. This is Northern California, and this is not a conventional tool that I'm gonna talk about, conventional geotechnical tool at all. This is a site in Northern California. There was immense flooding and damage of this area, and we found rainfall stations. And those rainfall stations show between 1.5 and 4 inches of rainfall over that 24-hour period. Now, the amount of damage was consistent with a much higher level of rainfall. So there were no sites closer to that, no rainfall stations. So what we did is we collected the radar data for rain cloud density, and there's a way to estimate, based on the cloud density, the amount of precipitation. So we did that, and we found it was very interesting. The rainfall stations, the radar data at the rainfall stations were very, very close to the measured values. And what was interesting was you see the yellow area around the site, that's a dense storm cell that passed over the site that missed the nearby rain stations. And we were able to utilize information, and this estimated about 7 to 8 inches of rainfall. So that explained the heavy amount of damage that occurred. So last thing I'm going to cover is just presentation of the results. As I mentioned, it's such a simple thing to say, but when we're dealing with these complex problems, performing our intense analysis and going through the grinding out the results and finding our conclusions, if we can't distill that information for our audience, then we're not doing our job and we're not being effective. And again, our audience could be a jury who not only they have no technical knowledge, but they also sometimes have no interest, right? So knowing our audience and preparing our results so they can be understood is a really important part of forensic engineering. And so if I were to leave with a couple final words, one is that to be aware of the tools available outside of our conventional toolbox. We know what our toolbox is. We know our comfort zone, but it's expanding outside of that. And this, of course, applies beyond forensics, right? But knowing what's outside of our toolbox. The other thing is taking those things that are outside of our toolbox and doing our best to add those to our toolbox and increase our abilities so we can do the best job that we can. Thank you.
What did we decide yesterday? Is it one push or three pushes to move? There we go. Well, I have an opportunity to, as a company, support this inaugural Prakash lecture as a sponsor, and we got a couple of minutes to bore you with our marketing material, and as Taki just said, it's all about presentation, and I was calibrating my presentation based on 2 drink tickets, but there was only 1 drink ticket given, so. Might be a little bit less interesting than I hope, so. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of Geosyntec, and there's a lot of former and current Geosyntec employees, people that have been associated with the company, so I won't bore you a lot. But just in summary, at this point, we're about 1,900 people company. I was at Geosyntec in 05, 06, we were only 500-600 people then. So it's been a tremendous amount of growth over the last 10, 15 years. I think goals get about to 5,000 people maybe in 5 years. So we'll see you at what 2028 conference, and we have expanded to a number of countries. And as you can see, we focus a lot about innovation, and you know, forward thinking. And you can see that by having a lot of people with advanced degrees in the firm. You see us all over the place with offices everywhere. But what I like to go back just as a little fun moment. I think we'll maybe have more chuckle out of it. This was the first Geosyntec office. Some that have been involved Geosyntec might know of it. Apparently it was in a former laundromat in a strip mall in Florida. And I heard a story that it was such an office they didn't want to bring a lot of clients in. So when the clients were coming to town, they would claim that the office has a roof leak. And then they would rent a conference room in a hotel nearby. And if anybody kept track, they probably had about 50 roof leaks every year. Based on that. And we do pride ourselves of getting together every year as a geotechnical practice group. And this was one of the first meeting in 84 when there was only a couple people. Now our geotechnical practice group is about 300 to 400 people. And I just want to close. I think it's a topic that's important to all of us, is sustainability. And I was talking to other people before. I think it's another of our focus and focus on all of us in the industry is to kind of look at our solutions that are, you know, really focusing on what we can do as engineers to smartly design. Maybe we can cut some concrete down or anything else that makes an impact. So I won't bore you much more, and I'm looking forward to the lecture, and thanks for having us here. And I'll move on to the next one. Thank you.
So I can remember. Turn, there we go. Okay, so first of all, hello everyone, my name's Ross Boulanger. I get the pleasure of introducing my friend and colleague, Jason DeJong, for this first ever new award from ASCE, the Prakash Lecture. I first met Jason when he took a foundation design class from me back in the early 1990s. And, you know, right away, you could tell he was going to be someone special, both for our profession and just as a person. And we've been friends ever since. He graduated in 96, and he went on to Georgia Tech, where he did his master's and PhD degree. He worked with our seed lecturer, David Frost, on those years. From there, he went to the University of Massachusetts at Amherst, where he was an assistant professor for 3 years, and then we successfully recruited him back to UC Davis, right? So we knew what we had, and it was great getting him back. Jason has been the consummate professor, the academician, kind of the model citizen on the campus. He has excelled in research as an educator, as a citizen, both in the campus and for the profession, and as a consultant for various agencies and firms dealing with a variety of different problems. If you look at his research and his more than 250 publications, you could probably put him into two broad categories. You know, one would be site and soil characterization, kind of a broad set of things, and then the work in the biogeotechnics field. He's got international recognition from both lines of work, and that's earned him a number of honors. These include the Hagen-Tagler, which is a best paper award from ASTM, twice, the TK Sci Prize and the Telford Premium Prize, which are both best paper awards from the Institute of Civil Engineers in the UK, the Arthur Casagrande Prize award and the Huber Prize from ASCE. And then locally on our campus, his contributions were recognized as an outstanding mid-career faculty research award. So he's been duly recognized for all his contributions. He's been a real leader in our professional community. Just to give some examples of his roles, he's chaired the ASCE Soil Properties Committee. He's chaired the International Society's In Situ Site Characterization Committee. He's the PI for the UC Davis part of the NSF Center for Bio-Inspired and Biomediated Geotechnics. That's the center that's partnered with ASU, Georgia Tech, and New Mexico State that Ed Cavazzangian leads. He has been, is a co-PI for the NSF NIRI Shared Use Geotechnical Centrifuge Facilities at UC Davis. And then in my personal favorite is in 3 months' time, he will be the director and PI of that facility. So he's taking the reins and leading us. He has a rare talent for seeing the arc of science and engineering and being able to envision how things change and evolve. And I think one way to kind of illustrate that is we'll talk about his biogeotechnics contributions just as an example. It's not what he's talking about today, but I wanted to say a few words about it. He, in that, has done a variety of different things in that discipline. In particular, he's well known for his work on microbial calcite-induced precipitation, or MICP. So back in 2006, his group published what I believe is the first paper demonstrating the use of MICP. That paper's got over 1,500 publications now. And now, and if you follow the arc of his work after that, you see it goes through and systematically takes the problem and has worked through developing the experimental methods and techniques for testing MICP in soils, understanding the biochemical, geochemical reactions, stimulation of the microbial background, optimizing treatment formulation, working on system response using centrifuge model tests, working on the effects on different kinds of properties, and then upscaling, working with industry, including Geosyntec, our sponsor, in upscaling this to the field implementation. So he's worked across those scales. And he was recognized for that work last year in the international conference in Sydney, where he was given an invited state-of-the-art lecture on MICP, and true to form, he and his colleagues generated an epic 100-page plus paper, which is a definitive paper that is worth looking at to kind of give you a sense of where that field is matured to. So what's my point? My point is his work has always gone straight from getting to the root of a problem and then working fundamentals of science all the way through application and implementation. And I think when we go through today's talk, you're going to see that. Right? And today, Jason's going to walk through looking at one aspect of his work in soil and site characterization. He's done CPTs and full flow penetrometers and lab tests and other things. But today's going to be about gravels. And you're going to see that work all the way from fundamentals through applications. And in fact, this work was kick-started by a project involving a reservoir founded on some deep deposits of gravelly and cobbly soils, where people were struggling with how to interpret penetration tests in that site. And he took on that problem, and in working with the industry partners, in less than a decade, moved that from a concept to implementation, working on the instrumented Becker in particular. That one part of this problem moved it from concept to implementation, eventually commercialization with CONTEC, and now to widespread adoption and use in industry practice. And doing that in under a decade is pretty amazing. And so I have to say that I've been really fortunate from the first time he was in my class to learn a lot from Jason. I've learned a lot on technical, but also on the non-technical stuff. Being around Jason has helped me be a better professor, a better mentor. I've learned a lot from him. That's what you call mentoring up, I think. And with all that, I think we're going to learn a lot today. I'm looking forward to the lecture. And please join me in welcoming Jason DeJong.
I was supposed to go shorter so you'd have more time, but I didn't.
Yeah. I believe Sissy's going to join us. Photo time. I'll let you two first. I want to get in on one.
Good evening, colleagues. This is certainly an honor and a privilege. I appreciate Ross for the introduction. I feel a bit the same as you did yesterday, David. It's who is this person they're talking about? It must be someone else. Being selected as the inaugural recipient of the ASCE Prakash Award is truly an honor and a privilege, and I hope to do it due justice over the next hour or so as I give this presentation. We've often talked among friends and colleagues that ASCE was maybe lacking an award in the mid-career phase, and now that has come to be true, I think that's fantastic. It's also been a bit entertaining, as early on when I was selected for this, I received congratulations very generously from different people, and after a little while, I realized some of the congratulations was simply that I was still eligible for a mid-career type award, so I have my birth certificate. I turned 50 in a few months, and so just slipped in underneath that, but it's an honor. And at the same time also, thinking about a mid-career presentation, it provides an opportunity perhaps to share work that we've been working on for a while, but we still have some open-ended questions and we still have work to do. We have another decade or more, I think, in this topic to really get what I'm gonna show you today refined. And so I appreciate it from that standpoint. The selection of this topic also came about in part respecting and remembering Professor Prakash's interest in geotechnical engineering, in soil dynamics, soil behavior, and case histories to a certain extent. So the way this presentation is cast is trying to honor that as well. So this was the original academic title of my presentation. More pragmatically, we're just going to talk about evaluating liquefaction of gravelly soils. And there's a number of people that have collaborated on this. I want to highlight in particular Alejandro Martinez, Katerina Ziotopoulou, Dan Wilson as colleagues, and also several postdocs, PhD students, and visiting scholars as well. So I hope I represent their work well. So let's go ahead and jump into this and think through this topic. We're going to do as Ross said. We're going to frame the problem in an idealized case history, and then we're going to walk through some basics to try to get fundamental understanding and propagate that through this problem, with the aim of appeasing some of the rigorous academic folks in the room, at the same time relating to and bringing along and connecting with the industry folks. So for gravelly soils, we have a challenge, I think, in that we have a challenge to extend our knowledge base from sandy and silty gravelly soils sandy and silty soils into more gravelly soils. And very basically, as we begin with the sand and we add more larger size particles to this material, there are some very simple but fundamental changes. The particle packing and the void ratio space changes, the hydraulic conductivity will change, and stiffness, stress dilatancy, and critical state changes take place. This is really 101 soil mechanics to a certain extent. But they map directly to influence is in the penetration resistance, how liquefaction triggering occurs, and the subsequent strains and deformations. And so this is just simply the problem I want to talk about. The workflow that we use to do this, generalized and simplifies in practice, is what you see in the following five steps. We obtain some in-situ penetration measurement. We need to apply some corrections to make sure it's appropriate. We estimate relative density or state parameter, and then we'll do liquefaction triggering evaluation and move on and do strains and deformations. Sometimes in analysis, we're only trying to get to the relative density, and then we'll go off and do something else. But if we're doing liquefaction evaluation, we actually oftentimes skip that step of relative density because we use a normalized penetration resistance directly in the subsequent analysis methods. But nonetheless, this is the generalized framework that I want to think through. And if we break this up into four parts, let's ask some relatively straightforward kinds of questions. In particular, when we're working with gravelly soils. So when does the presence of large particles affect the penetration measurement? And if that happens, how do I account for or correct for that? How does the effect of soil gradation influence penetration resistance? And how can I incorporate that in a systematic manner? Subsequently, how does soil gradation affect the liquefaction triggering process? And then, how does the effect of gradation affect post-triggering strains and deformations? So those are different parts. The approach we took to examine this problem was trying to control as many variables as possible so we can elucidate some of the parts of interest. So we have a series of poorly graded soils. That's those dashed lines there. And we make different mixes, and we lay this curve down towards the coarse grain size. We employed a variety of research methods, lab tests, discrete element modeling, centrifuge tests, to make observations on monotonic behavior, cyclic behavior, and penetration resistance. And we want to wrap this up and then understand what's happening with the triggering curve and what's happening with respect to strains and deformations in our built systems. So to get through this, we're going to walk through this following outline. I'm going to give you an idealized problem in practice to start. We're going to begin just with void ratio, something really simple on one hand, and understand element behavior, and then go on and do penetration resistance, triggering, strains, and deformations. So the problem in practice in an idealized sense. We know from literature that the gradations that, of these gravelly soils that liquefy are very well graded. You can see that in the grain size distribution curve shown to the right. And very often we have sufficient sand size particles that the hydraulic conductivity is really comparable to sands, though it's a gravelly material. When we use our in-situ penetrometers, SPT, CPT, instrumented Becker, dynamic penetration tests, whatever it may be, the driving of those can be elevated because of these particle sizes, and we need to be able to deal with that. But we collectively, I would say, have a lack of sufficient knowledge in how to characterize and to account for these soils. So let's consider a very simplified embankment dam. I'm sorry, but unfortunately some of the coloring didn't come through on this slide. But the center core is a silty sand core material. We have to the left and right of that a well-graded gravelly shell material. And that is all constructed on top of some natural alluvium, which is also a well-graded gravel. If it's like most of the time in practice, we don't have the historic characterization we want. We don't have the documentation from construction that we want either. And we have high seismic loading, so we have to do an updated risk assessment. We may go in, let's say, with a sonic rig and obtain samples from the various materials. And you can see here, for those color-coded zones for the core, the shell, and the alluvium, we're able to generate some different gradations. These gradations vary widely in terms of going up to a CU of about 80. They have low enough hydraulic conductivity to generate pore pressures when we shake these materials. And we have large enough particles that the penetration process is difficult. We need to understand and be able to interpret that. So let's look at our toolbox for a minute. We were speaking about toolboxes a minute ago. So let's look at our in-situ penetrometer toolbox. And we have three probes. The SPT and CPT you're certainly familiar with, shown on the right-hand side, as well as particles to scale. The big brother in the room is the instrumented Becker test. It's a large diameter. It's closed-ended like a CPT, driven dynamically by an SPT, and that's the other one we'll take a look at. So if we look at literature and say, what do we know right now? What's the state of knowledge? We find it's limited in its guidance. The first, with respect to SPT, we can see Kohaui and Maine had identified the contribution of D50 to elevating the penetration resistance. Mejia and later Gafgazi et al. Refined the observation that when you have about 20% gravel, you're probably going to be encountering elevated blow counts because of the presence of those gravelly materials. For the CPT, there's less information and the observations are very disparate. And they say somewhere between 20 to 3 in terms of the ratio of the probe diameter to particle size, and you're going to start seeing some of these effects and you're going to have some issues. So there's some refinement to be made there. The instrumented Becker, to add a little bit to that, this is the test that Ross had mentioned, and it actually began signing a contract 10 years ago this month with LADWP to start working on some of this. But it's a large diameter driven probe. The key part in this is the fact that we have comprehensive instrumentation at the tip. Not only strains and acceleration, but also temperature monitoring and lock and our ability to track residual force. And so as a result, we don't need a subsequent inverse analysis or anything else to solve that problem. We have the measurements straight away. And for more than 30 industry projects now, we have our blow penetration per blow, our blows with depth, and then we can convert to some other metric where we can then estimate liquefaction triggering. So let's return to our idealized problem in practice. Let's first look at the core. This is straightforward. This is a poorly graded sand, CU of about 2, D85, which becomes our critical metric, of about 2 as well. So all the methods will work. We're probably going to use CPT because of efficiency and cost, but all of them are viable from a technical perspective. The shell material is well graded, CU of 50, but a D85 of about 4 inches. We have large particles in this shell material, and as a result, SPT, CPT won't work, and even the instrumented Becker is being challenged by this large diameter material. If we look at the alluvium, it's also well graded, but that D85 size is on the order of about 1 inch. We can probably get the SPT and CPT through the material, but just because we get it through the material and get a number, is it meaningful? What do we do with that? Is that appropriate? And the instrumented Becker would work, I think, without issue. So we have our tools, we can obtain the measurement, and now we need to estimate relative density, triggering, and strains and deformation. So that's the next steps we have to go through. But before we jump there, let's first go back to basics for a little bit and just look at a simple question. How does soil gradation affect the soil behavior? And so we're going to start, first of all, just talking about coefficient of uniformity. Very simple metric, looking at the gradation and the ratio of those. It's easy to obtain from disturbed samples, so the cost is minimal. It's very accessible. The gradation matters at both the D10 and the D85 level. The D10 roughly, the square of that is proportional to hydraulic conductivity. That's allowing these pore pressures to be generated. And at the same time, the D85 is controlling the influence of the particle size to the penetrometers. We don't use percent gravel because both sands and gravel behavior is primarily governed by gravimetric stresses. And that is that the threshold between those two is largely arbitrary. And if you're using USCIS classification in the US, you're using something in another country, the gravel threshold moves around. So that's not as relevant as the gradation. We collected data from about 160 different projects and references. These are test soils, natural geologic materials, as well as man-made materials during construction. And we can see on the left for the maximum void ratio, and on the right for the minimum void ratio, these trends persist, and they're relatively clear. What surprised us, and what was interesting, is that we see between about a CU of 2 and 12, we get most of our change. And that reduction is about a factor of 2. The void ratios are going from 0.9 to 0.45. So we're going to remember that range, and we're going to remember that that can be modeled reasonably as that kind of hyperbolic function. To tackle this, we took a natural alluvial material, slot sieved it, and we're able to recreate and be able to generate a whole suite of different test soils, 10 in all. We're going to focus primarily just on 4 of them today. And you can see them across the top with our little 6-millimeter cone pictured on top of those materials. Just to highlight a few things, you can see the gradations changing from about 1.5 to 12. The void ratios corresponding to 45% relative density drop in half, as we talked about before. We intentionally controlled hydraulic conductivity. So all of these soils have the same hydraulic conductivity, which means the observations of pore pressure generation we see later on don't depend on hydraulic conductivity, because that was a constant variable for us. And shear wave velocity or shear modulus increases systematically. And this isn't a surprise, because Meng's work in 2003 mapped this out, and the data agrees well with it. You can look at the bottom right-hand plot. That's all the scatter from the previous figure in the background. And you can see these four soils track that transition zone that we were particularly interested in. So I think we're well poised. Let's now look, there's additional soils, which we are not going to talk about for the most part. But we have to bring in a couple. So at times you're going to see a 3Cu material show up. And you're going to see also poorly graded materials, which just are larger and larger particle sizes, but same gradation. So now let's look at some basic laboratory tests. Triaxial behavior on the right-hand side. This is drained results, very low relative density, relatively high state parameter. And we can see the results are basically the same. There's a perceptible trend, but it's on the order of 15%. So it's not that substantial. As we go to the bottom right in terms of relative density, but it's actually clearer in terms of state, you can see the peak strength going up pretty significantly. And this is due in part to what we see with the critical state lines on the left. That critical state line is dropping because of the void ratio change. But interestingly, it's also becoming flatter and flatter and flatter, which means if we're below critical state, we're going to get stronger dilation. If we're above critical state, we have the potential to generate pore pressures a little bit quicker. We can pull on some of the classic correlation functions that are in the literature, including Bolton's 86 relationship. That's shown in the upper left figure. And we can see here, again, systematically across different confining stresses on the x-axis, different relative density lines shown with the black lines for reference, that for any relative density, we see the difference between the peak and the critical state friction angle increasing as we march through this. In terms of state on the right-hand side, same trends persist. If you're not quite as familiar with state parameter, you can think of the right-hand side being looser or loose of critical, left-hand side being dense or dense of critical. But more pragmatically, peak friction angle, what's that telling us? And you can see that data in the lower left figure. You can see a pretty systematic increase in the peak friction as we go through this material. Dilation rate correspondingly in the bottom right figure. So we're seeing these trends, and the question is, where are they coming from? And so we turned to discrete element modeling to take a look at this. We calibrated a discrete element model to reasonably match some of the experimental data, and you can see some results of that in the bottom left for drain tests. Same observations, the peak Q is increasing, and we're falling back to a pretty common critical state value. It also plays out in the Bean and Jeffrey state parameter space, so again, we're tracking some similarities. But again, DM, we want you to show us what's going on at a more fundamental level. And so what we're looking at here on the upper left images, the two in yellow, is for the poorly graded sand. You can look, and it's a slice through the middle of our simulations, and you can see the series of black lines that exist exhibiting the force structure. The lines are pretty well distributed. The thicknesses are pretty equal initially under the isotropic stress state. And then when we shear and we load it, they become oriented in that vertical direction. If we move to the right, we can consider the contact forces between these individual particles. You can see on the diagonal, there's a label of 1.0, if you can read it. But above that is considered a strong contact. Below that is considered a weaker contact. So this is above average, if you will, or below average contact forces. And you can see about one-third of that space are weak contacts, and they're below. And then if we look on the far right-hand side, the maximum normalized value is only a ratio of about 3.5. So those forces are not particularly widely distributed or particularly strong. But let's look at the well-graded soil beneath it. That well-graded soil beneath it, you can see very strong contacts. You can see many, many contacts for every large particle, initially oriented isotropically, equal in all directions. and then later on becoming more oriented vertically. We do the same mapping to the right-hand side, and now that diagonal one contour really drops down and to the left, which is indicating that a vast majority of the particles, of the larger particles, have higher forces propagating through them than do some of the small particles. So we're learning and we're seeing that those large particles are directly engaged in the force chain, the transfer of load, and the shearing process. Two other things to take a look at, is, since we're interested in liquefaction, is the cyclic behavior. And so here's some representative results from simple shear testing. On the left, poorly graded. On the right, more well graded. The part that's not quite so evident from these curves is that the initial number of cycles to triggering is perhaps unchanged. Some literature indicates that actually it could take fewer cycles. Some other literature says maybe a couple more cycles. That's not very clear yet. We still need more investigation there. But what is clear is that if we liquefy, the rate of strain accumulation post-triggering is smaller. You see how many more cycles it takes to get to 10% strain in the right figure than the left-hand figure. And we can aggregate data and do triggering curves like on the left-hand side, which right now indicates a little bit of a shift to the left as the soil becomes more well-graded. And on the right-hand side, we can see post-cyclic reconsolidation strains. For these two soils, we're getting about one-half or about a 30% reduction in the reconsolidation strains. Okay, so that's a lot to set the problem up on a fundamental perspective. But we can pause and we can say a few things to recap. The void ratio reduces substantially as gradation increases. The large particles are directly involved in the force chain and in that mechanism. You see the critical state line drop and become flatter in EP space. That results in strong dilation as the soil becomes more well graded. And we also have increases in stiffnesses, which had been documented previously by others. And that's important because penetration resistance depends on stiffness and on peak friction, almost primarily. So let's look at that and how this maps forward to in situ characterization. Here's a generalized flow chart that I think is representative. We'll obtain some penetration measurement. We'll obtain an energy correction if necessary, do other measurement corrections, do a stress normalization, have our corrected measurement in order to estimate relative density. This is pretty universal if you're doing SBT or CPT or any other method. For CPT, because that's what we're going to spend some time on, we can simply make our QC measurement, have our pore pressure of U2, correct for that, correct for overburden stress. We'll get our QT1 and we can get our relative density. This is familiar, right? This is familiar territory. For gravels, we have to do two additional things. We need to add a probe to particle ratio correction factor. This is a CP term and we're going to develop that in a few minutes. We also need to add something to properly incorporate, not correct for, but incorporate the effects of gradation on this material. So to recap, we need two things. We need a CP term to correct for the probe to particle ratio, and we need a C sub CU term to incorporate the influence, if you will, of soil gradation. And what we develop, we believe, is conceptually applicable to other penetration materials as well. So let's do this for the CPT. We have our basic cone measurements. We do our pore pressure correction as standard. We do our stress normalization as is standard in practice as well. Those are all established. We need to add a probe to particle size correction right here. And what we're essentially doing is trying to say, if the probe was large enough compared to my soil, what would the correct measurement be without those large particles compromising that failure mechanism, causing those artificially large blow counts? The second one, again, is incorporating the effect of coefficient of uniformity. And we'll do this within the established functional form developed by Bali that you see on the bottom left. So we'll go from that, and we'll now take a look at data to try to populate and to inform this. And we did this through the small centrifuge test using the soils that we showed. It's a level ground model. It's curved in the picture, I know, but that's the G field of the centrifuge test. And we prepared models to initially 40% relative density. We pushed cones at different points in time to track the effects of relative density, but also track the effects of the particle size to probe size. And we shook these models multiple times, triggering liquefaction, forcing densification, so we can have this matrix of information. So you can imagine it's quite a few curves, a lot of plot profiles. We're just going to pull out a couple to highlight, first of all, visually and conceptually, to see what we're looking at and see what we need to try to correct for. So here you go. On the left-hand side, this is push with a 6-millimeter cone. The left profile in the gray line is poorly graded sand. There's no problem with that profile at all. That's correctly measured. The red line is at about the same relative density, but the particle size is 10 times larger. So every large particle it feels, it generates this chatter that's going back and forth in the profile. And that elevates the overall measures by about a factor of 2. So what happens then if I change to a larger probe? Do these effects go away? Not entirely, but to a certain degree, they do go away. That larger probe now reduces that scaling effect. We see the magnitude drop, and we see the amount of variability drop also. Let's add 2 more figures to this. The first one now is that same gray, poorly graded reference, but now the blue line is a well-graded material, and it also has D85 or particle size effects buried in there. The magnitude is higher, but the amount of variability has gone down, so that's a combined effect, and we want to be able to tease those apart. Go to a larger probe, now the curve or that profile is relatively quiet. Those large particle effects have been largely mitigated. We're seeing a significant effect on the coefficient of variation. So that's it graphically, but we need the structure in order to apply this. So the probe correction, first of all. We can develop this with a few assumptions which held true largely for our data. The effect is constant with respect to confining stress. The effect is constant across the range of relative densities we tested. And the effect is multiplicative on the CP effect. So the functional forms below, the information's on the right. And on that x-axis, we're looking on log scale at the ratio of the probe to particle. And the vertical is the correction magnitude. So on the far right, if you look at the data, you can see the value is 1. That is, there's nothing to correct for because the ratio is sufficiently large that we're getting the correct measurement. But as particles become larger and larger and larger, we have greater correction to apply for. And so if we look at this, there's a few practical takeaways. When that ratio is about 4, and so for a 15 square centimeter cone, this would be a half inch diameter particle compared to your standard cone, your measurements might be elevated by about 20%. But there's a boundary to which we can actually apply this, and that's probably at a ratio of 2. I mean, when your particles are equal to the radius of your probe, that is probably not correctable in any reliable manner, and we shouldn't push it beyond that boundary. The second one we have to correct for is the effect of gradation. Now here, you can see in the top left, we're using the same functional form as we did with void ratio. And this is one of the key assumptions we're making in developing this piece, is that we saw that that range or change of contribution of gradation is mapped from a CU of 2 to about a CU of 12. In the second part, if you look at the equation in the upper right, let's just focus on the cone tip divided by those two terms, the multiplication of those two terms. That's the magnitude of correction or adjustment we might apply. So we can plot those together in the figure on the right. Again, that ratio is on the x-axis. The total correction is on the vertical axis. First of all, the right-hand side, you can see the correction for the gradation occurring, going from 1 to 12. And as we go to the left, we're getting our probe correction being applied at the same time. So let's make this be a little more practical for a takeaway. If I'm pushing a cone in a poorly graded sand, there's no correction to be made. The system is working right. Let's take the measurement and run with it. If I'm working in a well-graded soil, my penetration resistance may be elevated by up to 50% because of the effects or contributions of gradation. If I'm in a poorly graded gravel, however, I can have the same magnitude of correction, about 55%, but for entirely different reasons. It's not because the soil properties are necessarily different, it's because of this penetrometer size effect. And if I had the combination of those two, the total correction could be on the order of a factor of 2. And this net correction is actually pretty comparable to what Skempton had shown before, and also Kubernovsky and Ishihara's work. So let's propagate this through to the relative density equation, and that's what we have here. Here's our data, plus the range, the specific curves for each of those four soils that we developed. In addition, we can just lay it out for the full range of CU values, 1 to 13 or 12. And remember, after 12, the function is largely saturated. So 12 is similar to 30, is similar to 60. We can see that this would indicate that our measurements could be 7, or it could be about 10.5. And in both cases, it's a 50% relative density material. The effect of gradation can cause that much of a change. We know that a lot of the original correlations for relative density were based off of poorly graded sands. And we know practically poorly graded sands don't really exist below a CU of about 2. And USCS says that they stop at 6. So here's those three contours. So that spread you see is probably one of the main contributors to the data set used to develop relative density correlations. We can add on top of this Yamokowski, Kohaui, and Main, and Idris and Boulanger correlations, and you can see that they kind of fall within this range, perhaps confirming this kind of understanding. Okay, we can have our methodology, so let's just map through it with a couple of examples from the large centrifuge test. We have our raw profile of measurements. We can do stress normalization. We can remove the effects of the elevated or large particles. And we can get to pretty accurate estimates of relative density, confirming that we built models as we had targeted. So we have the liquefaction triggering part, the cone penetration resistance part. And now let's look at liquefaction triggering. So that's that fourth box on the bottom. And I'll note we're doing this primarily on an RU equal to 1 basis because that is much easier and realistic to assess, particularly from centrifuge test data. And once we make some observations there, we're going to look and see how it impacts the triggering curve. So how did we come about this? Those same centrifuge tests I talked about before for the CPT, we shook many times. So we accumulated about 150 different events spread across different soils where we know the relative density and we know what the shaking magnitude would be. Now, some of this data in the more red values here are for coarser and coarser grain particles, and you see that that data in red doesn't propagate all the way to the right. And that's because we couldn't generate pore pressures and liquefy the soil, so that represents more of a drain shakedown type of densification. So we'll pull those out. We'll stay with this, which is the effects from the well-graded materials only. And to just provide a few insights, we're gonna grab two clusters of events and just make some initial comparisons. The first one's at the beginning of the sequence, about 50% relative density. The other one is much later on at about 70% relative density and larger shaking magnitude. So at the top of our models, we have an array of, a pseudo-element array with instruments inside of them, so we can do some analysis. So on the left, poorly graded sand, the tip measurement was about 8 MPa, 50% relative density. You go to the middle figure on the left, and you can see that the pore pressure in terms of RU rises in a couple cycles, and we've liquefied the soil pretty early on. You see, as a result, there's not a lot of cyclic resistance, not a lot of acceleration propagating through this material, and the reconstructed stress strain loop on the bottom, the material is liquefied, right? The material on the right, it's more well graded, the response isn't actually a whole lot different initially. If you look at the top, the cone tip resistance for this was 12 MPa, so it's about 50% higher, but it's at the same relative density. We see pore pressures rise about the same rate, maybe a little bit slower. We see a little bit more cyclic resistance at reversals, but not a substantial amount. We can go on to a higher relative density, 72%. And now the differences start to become a little bit more evident. The left-hand side, again, poorly graded soil, relative density of 70%, cone tip of 13 MPa. On the left-hand side, on the RU plot, again, you can see pore pressures rise within a few cycles, and persist, but you now start to see some dilation spikes occurring and some cyclic resistance being mobilized, and that's evident in the stress-strain loops beneath it as well. The more well-graded material, the 8Cu material on the right-hand side, the pore pressure still rises, but during that loading, you see strong oscillations in the pore pressure. That's coming from the cyclic reversals and that strong dilative tendency that you have with more well-graded material. That really is more manifest in the plot on the bottom right, which shows the cyclic resistance and it shows the peak values at every stress reversal. So grabbing those two observations, that puts us in a context to think about what shifts might occur in the liquefaction triggering curve. We've seen previously, when you're looking at penetration resistance, we see a systematic shift in QT1N. We're not seeing a lot of changes in CRR, and some of the literature is indeterminate on that, so we'll hold that constant for now. And we can then look and see how the triggering curve might shift. But we need to benchmark it in something. So what you're looking at here in the black line is Boulanger and Idris triggering curve. And this was largely based off of relatively clean, poorly graded sands, less than 5% fines. And pragmatically, we know these natural soils will probably have a CU of at least 2. It's rare to have a natural material which is less than 2. And they're defined by USCS to be less than 6. So that's our window, 2 to 6. And maybe 4 is representative, the value right in the middle. So if we benchmark Boulanger and Idris with a fines content of 4, then the spread from 2 to 6 could be possibly attributed to the effects of gradation. And this is maybe a contributor to the uncertainty we have about where that triggering curve exists. More broadly, we can see that as we go over the full range of gradations, it's possible to have maybe a 50% increase or range in the penetration resistance value depending on the gradation only. All the effects of particle size are separate and removed from this. So we could observe that, yes, the material is as susceptible, but we should expect this triggering curve potentially to shift to the right because gradation is increasing the penetration resistance. So this leads us on to the last part, which is volumetric and shear strains. And ultimately, this was really the question we're after. When we're designing, I'm not that concerned about what the tip resistance is. I'm not that concerned if it triggers or not. I'm concerned about permanent deformations and permanent strains. So that's why we wanted to push towards getting some insights into this aspect. We're going to go to a large centrifuge now. This model you see on the right-hand side is scaled by 40G. It's about a 6-meter tall slope on a 6-meter high slope, a 10-degree slope. We built 6 of these different models, 2 per container, so they're side by side. We subjected them to repeating shaking events of increasing magnitude, and that design of that shaking motion was really important because we have a ramp, we have a hold, and we have a decay range. That ramp is to try to figure out when triggering will occur. The hold range provides some insight into the accumulation of strains, and the decay provides us insight into when the displacements will arrest as pore pressures dissipate. We can push the 10-millimeter cone in this material. And one of the important parts is the transparent sidewalls, the high-speed video cameras, as well as some colored markers to be able to track. We're going to focus, for sake of time, just at some of the results at the top of the slope, both in the upper part of the slope and in the mid-slope in that instrument array. But before we go into numbers, let's look at the videos. So across the top is poorly graded. Across the bottom is well graded. Red lines are your benchmark, your pre-shaking kind of conditions. And so you can see two things that are occurring as this video re-loops back through, is that first of all, we have dynamic straining of both of the materials. In all places, the material is dynamically straining back and forth to some extent. But the permanent deformations are certainly greater for the more poorly graded material. And this was observed systematically across all of our different tests. So behind those red lines and that black marker, we have sensors inside of our material. We can go in and interrogate those specific measurements and learn what's coming from inside of there. So let's look at these. I realize with this screens you may not be able to read the axes, so I'll try to talk that through with you. On the left-hand side, the top is the poorly graded material. And look at the black lines first, the delta U. These are the excess pore pressures generated. And what do we see? We see pore pressures generated quickly. We see liquefaction triggering. And then towards the end, when we get out of that dark gray zone, which is the decay, we see a pore pressure rise. And we have excess pore pressure dissipation occurring through upward water flow through our model. And it takes about 400 seconds to fully dissipate those pore pressures after shaking. You can see when you're liquefied like that and it's poorly graded, you're not transmitting a lot of accelerations. And down below, you can go to the well-graded model. And in this case, actually, the mean value or the trend is similar. The pore pressures generate at about the same time. So on an RU basis, the triggering is pretty much coincident. But look at the spikiness of that. We're generating a lot of dilation at stress reversals. You still see the dissipation of pore pressures as it goes up. But now look how fast pore pressure dissipation occurs. It's about 5 times faster in the more well-graded material. Mid-slope, again, the stories are a little bit different, but they're also similar. Pore pressure rises quick. We stay liquefied for a period of time, and now the pore pressures drop. That's due to the static shear stress trying to drive this slope down. You can see the pore pressure dissipation time is also pretty comparable. The dilation spikes are much stronger on the slope because of these strong dilative kinds of effects. So let's take these measurements and now let's look at some pseudo-element responses inside of the model. On the left-hand side, again, poorly graded across the top. And on the left-hand side, you can see the stress-strain loops on the left, if you will, and on the right-hand side, the pore pressure. And the coloring is just coding in time. So we see poorly graded material. We see a little bit of dilation occurring and mobilized cyclic resistance at the reversals. When we go down to the 12 CU material, we see more strong mobilization of dilation as we're getting to these stress reversals. We're generating a cyclic resistance. On slope, similar type of response, except the evidence of that driving static shear stress is more pronounced. The right-hand side, you can see, first of all, with the pore pressures, those strong negative pore pressures coming through, and that's due to the strong dilation being mobilized at reversals. The dynamic loops, if you will, or the responses on the left-hand side, you can see they're a little bit more constrained for the well-graded material. All of the data we just looked at is coming from the accelerometer, so that's dynamic response. But we're interested in permanent response and permanent deformations. And this is where one more slide before that. I talked here, let me go back. I talked here, and I said that the amount of time for pore pressure dissipation is much longer in the poorly graded material than in the well-graded material. And this was something that was surprising and interesting to us. And so if we interrogate that a little bit further and look at each record, as we're showing in the top, of the total time where your pore pressure remains above an RU of 0.5, how long is that? And we can see that as we go from the poorly graded material in the gray circles down to the most well-graded material in the blue squares, we have about an 80% reduction in the time that the pore pressures remain highly elevated. Now remember, the hydraulic conductivities are the same. So it's not due to hydraulic conductivity. It's primarily due to the initial lower void ratio and the greater stiffness and bulk modulus of the soil matrix, so you're getting faster dissipations from that perspective. Okay, now let's go to our displacements and our permanent strains. So you're looking at here now PIV analysis of the colored sand columns for the soil on shake 3 with the same relative density. Two observations. The first is obvious. It's just the magnitude. But the second one to take a look at is the variation or the profile of those displacements with depth. Should go a second time. And look at the top one in particular. You're going to see that you have some non-uniform deformations with depth. In the top plot, on the bottom plot, it remains a little bit more uniform throughout that profile. And so we can go in and start quantifying these terms as well. We're going to look at elements of displacement right near the ground surface on the upslope and midslope. And what we see, again, comparing the dark blue for the most well-graded material to the light gray for the most poorly graded material, significant reductions in displacements. They reduced as you go from a CU of about 2 to 12. Our displacements are reduced on the order of 50 to 80% horizontally, 60% or more vertically. And in fact, we see some dilation or heaving of the ground surface in certain places because of the strength of dilation. But displacements at the ground surface are kind of an accumulation of all of the behavior beneath it, and that's just a surface manifestation. So we can also look at the shear strains just in that top zone. And in that case, the trends are the same, but we see here that the shear strains are reduced on the order of 40 to 90. Volumetric strains can be greater than 60%. So that's pretty promising, if you will, or insightful. Two questions remain. When is it happening during the shaking event? And how is it happening spatially throughout my model? So let's look at, first of all, when. So for shake three, we're looking at the top elements. Again, on the left-hand side now is shear strains on the upslope. And you can see we get triggering during the initial ramp portion of the loading. We see a pretty stable, systematic slope in all of the trends for both soils during that hold part. This is when our cyclic loading is the same, and we're just steadily accumulating strains. And then after that, in the decay phase, we have pore pressure dissipation occurring at different rates, and that's mapping to sooner or more gradual stops or slowdowns in our displacements and in our strains. The bottom, not surprisingly, on the right-hand side, the amount of shear strains mid-slope, when it's more well-graded, is about half of what it is when it's more poorly graded. And below that, on mid-slope, the poorly graded soil contracts slightly, and the more well-graded soil actually shows some evidence of dilation and the ground surface moving upward. The second question is, where is it occurring? So here we have broken up the mapping of the shear strains throughout the slope in the three different shaking phases. We begin on the left. When we are ramping, we're just triggering at this point. Our RU of 1 is being triggered well at small strains. So we're not nearly at 3% shear strain at this point. During the hold phase, that's with steady high magnitude shaking. We're seeing strains in both of the models. It's becoming more localized in the 2CU, in the more poorly graded model. And then during the decay phase, because of the extended pore pressure time for pore pressure dissipation, we're seeing an accumulation of up to about 10 to 12% shear strain in the poorly graded model. The well-graded model remains much, much more modest. Okay, we've walked through a lot, but with that, let's look at conclusions and try to answer some of the questions we posed up front. Here was our flow chart. And so let's bring that back and let's ask and try to answer some of these questions. The first one, when does the presence of large particles begin to affect the penetration resistance? And we said when that ratio becomes less than about 4, the influence is probably starting to exceed about 20%. Below that, at 10% or something, we have spatial variability, we have all kinds of other uncertainties. We don't have to worry about that so much, perhaps. When should this correction be applied, or what correction should be applied? This is this CP term. And we noted we can have a correction up to maybe a factor of 1.6 or so. But what's not really wise, if our particles are equal to the radius of this probe, to still think we can correct for it reliably. We have to be a little bit more conservative in our assessments at that point. For the relative density, we have this C sub CU term, which can systematically incorporate the effects of gradation into the relative density calculation scheme. We saw the triggering curve on an RU of 1 basis shift systematically to the right. And that range can be a factor of about 50%. So we can have a well-graded material, which has 50% higher tip resistance, and a poorly graded material. And they both have corresponding triggering lines. And lastly, for strains and deformations, both strains, shear strains and volumetric strains, decrease. The range depends on the gradation. It depends on the relative density. It depends on the magnitude of shaking, but it can be significant. With respect to our idealized scenario we started with, for all of our soils, I think we want to start thinking about considering and incorporating the effect of soil gradation, this C sub C U-turn. With respect to probe corrections, that's a bit more challenging, but for the poorly graded core, we can do everything as is, business as usual, standard of practice, we're fine with. The shell material, the SPT, the CPT won't work, and even the instrumented Becker is going to need a correction because those 4-inch or 3-inch particles are pretty sizable compared to the diameter of the probe. The alluvial material, the correction asked of the CPT and SPT are probably not reasonable. The diameter is about equal to the size of these probes. The instrumented Becker, we could do that, and we would not have to use necessarily the CP correction. I will say if we're moving on and implementing this in practice, we are going to have to select representative units. We're going to have samples and make selections of representative D85 values and C sub U values. But this may not be that difficult because once the trends with respect to CU saturate above about 20, then I don't have to worry, is the CU 50 or is it 65? That is not as significant of a question necessarily. We expect the triggering to still occur, for it to be still susceptible on an RU of one basis. And we can expect higher blow counts or higher penetration resistances because of gradation. And lastly, we expect these strains to be decreasing as the soil becomes more and more well graded. So with that, this doesn't happen alone. Our careers don't happen alone. This is a journey with people and in community. So I first want to just acknowledge the folks that were running the centrifuge tests, the small and large centrifuge tests, as well as a number of the different students. I can't find one picture that has everyone in it, but the photo on the left is of the Davis group at a point in time several years ago when many of these students were at Davis. Certainly my colleagues, former and current colleagues, their collegiality, their collaboration, and their mentorship mean a lot to me as well. The mentorship from David Frost, this is us in 2001 in Istanbul at the conference on the left-hand side, and of Paul Main and Don DeGroote with Julie and I on the right-hand side, those relationships and mentorship over the years have certainly been valuable. And not last but not least, Julie and I with our 3 kids, life is a journey and it's best spent together, and so this was one of the perks of the pandemic of us going through and doing John Muir Trail. And so grateful to everyone from that perspective. Obviously, sponsorship and funding to do all this is very important as well. So thank you. Thank you again for this opportunity.
Thanks, Jason, for a great lecture, for starting our relationship with the Prakash lecture and the Prakash Award so nicely. That was great. So I hope everybody enjoyed it tonight. We have a couple of announcements before the other third of the people leave the room. If you're going to the basketball game tonight, there are instructions on your ticket where to go. If you're not going and you have a ticket, we do ask, please give it to somebody who is, so we can use them all. We would really appreciate that. There was a lot of demand for these. We had some great vendor demos in the GI booth today. Stop by tomorrow. We will have a couple of more. Seats were full. People looked happy. That's success to me. You can also make your donations to Student Participation Fund there and get some great thank you gifts, Terzaghi bobbleheads, socks, shirts, etc. Student awards will be in the plenary session tomorrow morning near the end of the session. Please stick around for that to congratulate them on the excellent work they did at the competitions today. We're going to start with a CEO panel tomorrow that Yoga Chandran prepared for us lovingly, and it is going to be wonderful. So please come back in the room tomorrow at 8 for that. We would love to see you. Final reminder that all students are invited to a reception with our organizational members tonight from 7:30 to 8:30 in room 502B. And I think we're going to stop there because you've heard enough of this. So everybody have a wonderful night, and we'll see you back here tomorrow morning.